Stock investors kicked off the week on a cautious note as the Fed is expected to kill joy when it announces its latest monetary policy decision tomorrow, and well, earnings announcements may not save the day. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. So the US equities kicked off the week on a negative note as many investors out there preferred booking their profits before the deluge of corporate earnings announcements in the US and, well, the Federal Reserve decision due as soon as tomorrow. And investors are certainly not wrong to be scared, because the Federal Reserve expectations became increasingly dovish throughout the month of January as investors saw the easing inflation figures combined to the softening economic activity data. And even if the US GDP beat analyst expectations last week, remember that? Well, that strength in the GDP data was mostly due to the inventories readjustment and government spending. And while Germany, for example, couldn't spark the same enthusiasm than in the US when it released its own GDP report yesterday, because German economy contracted 0.2% in the fourth quarter and the yearly growth fell to 0.5% versus 0.8% penciled in by analysts and down from 1.3% printed earlier. So that kind of raised worries that Europe may not avoid recession after all. The DAX fell slightly yesterday, but is still holding on to the stronger levels that it saw in almost a year now, while the sell-off that we saw in the S&P 500 was a bit more severe, with the index giving back 1.30% of its value yesterday. Now, we are still above the 2022 bearish trend and above the 200-day moving average, but we know that we can't rely on Jerome Powell to keep this party going. Only stronger than expected earnings and ideally sufficiently good and strong profit guidance from the companies could do it. And let's be honest, spitting out a good guidance in this environment won't be a piece of cake for a good amount of them. So we will have an idea on the health of the advertisement market when Snap reports its quarterly earnings today. How poorly the metaverse is doing when Meta reports its own quarterly results on Wednesday. How much consumers spend when Amazon reports its own quarterly earnings on Thursday, and how well the business in China is doing when Apple and Starbucks both report their quarterly earnings on Thursday as well. And according to the latest news, well, Apple did manage to win its biggest quarterly market share in China in the last 3 months of last year, defying the COVID disruptions, the chaos in its Zhengzhou plant, remember the Foxconn plant, and a global economic slowdown. I mean, Apple also did suffer shipment declines from the previous year as other earthly smartphone makers did, but they were smaller than those of Samsung, for example, and even smaller than the domestic rivals like Vivo, Oppo, or Xiaomi. So as a result, iPhone accounted for nearly 24% of the Chinese smartphone sales in the last quarter of last year. But alas, the latter news, as great as they sounded, didn't prevent Apple from falling 2% at yesterday's trading session and slipping back into the bearish trend following failure to hold ground at the important 38.2% Fibonacci retracement level that stands near the $144 per share. And while other technology stocks were battered as well at yesterday's trading session for good or bad reasons, Tesla, for example, tanked more than 6% yesterday after Ford announced that it will cut the price of its Mustang Mach-E by up to $5,900 as a response to Tesla's cut by up to $13,000. Now, this price war among electric car makers will certainly squeeze their profits and may or may not make them gain enough market share to temper these losses. Now, the only thing is, for Tesla, well, Tesla's high per vehicle profitability gives it an advantage in this price war, it is said. Now, an advantage, certainly yes, but Tesla wants to produce 2 million cars this year if everything goes well, while Toyota spit more than 10 million cars last year, so Tesla still has a ways to go. Anyway, The 6% drop in Tesla shares yesterday and more than 2% fall in FANG stocks clearly weighed on Nasdaq. The index spent only a day above its 200-day moving average and fell below it. And oh, China's CSI index, which opened in the bull market yesterday after the Lunar New Year break, couldn't consolidate gains, and gains accumulated since November are again below the 20% mark this morning, while U.S. crude fell 2% at yesterday's trading session and slipped below the 50-day moving average this morning in Asia, and will step back into the June to December negative trend if the price falls below the $76.50 per barrel level. But why? Because interestingly, while the latest news on the macroeconomic front is not bad at all, the Chinese reopening is now well reflected through the first set of economic data that comes in, because released today in China, both the manufacturing and services PMI data jumped into the expansion zone above the 50 level, and services expanded faster, of course, with people, Chinese people, celebrating the end of the strict COVID measures along with the new Lunar Year. And further good news is that no new COVID variant has been detected so far, while almost 8 Chinese out of 10 have apparently already caught COVID since early December. And well, the cherry on top of all this, the IMF raises growth forecast for this year, guys and girls, by 0.2% to 2.9%, citing the resilience of the US spending and obviously the Chinese reopening. Plus, they now see inflation slowing this year in more than 80% of the country. So normally, this is the kind of news that the energy markets cheer, but not this time apparently. Plus, if the IMF news is great for many, many big economies out there, including Russia, well, Brits should not enjoy the new estimates as much as the others, because the British economy is expected to contract 0.6% this year. And well, something like 500,000 people will be going on a strike tomorrow in Britain to ask for a better pay, among other things. And the day after that, the Bank of England will have to announce a rate hike, 25 or 50 basis points, but a rate hike still. So what do you do with sterling? Well, I think it's not the best time to go long sterling, because yesterday's unpleasant inflation surprise in Spain, in Spanish inflation, could actually be seen in other economies as well today, including French and German inflation numbers. So that would further boost European Central Bank hawks and strengthen the case for a further rebound in the euro sterling at the current levels, just above the 50 and 100 day moving average zone. And against the US dollar, well, if cable ends this week above the 122.25 level, which is the major 38.2% Fibonacci retracement, well, it would be already a very, very good thing, because the US dollar is now gaining some good positive momentum into the Federal Reserve meeting, as everybody pretty much guesses that the Federal Reserve won't declare victory over inflation despite the falling inflation lately. Why? Because, well, that trend in inflation could actually reverse all of a sudden. In this sense, as I said earlier, the Spanish inflation yesterday came as a punch on the Europeans' face, as the inflation in Spain advanced to 5.8% in January instead of falling to 4.7% as expected by analysts. So that's almost a full percentage point of gap between the inflation expectation and the reality. So it was a bad surprise. And obviously, nothing guarantees that the same won't happen in France and in Germany and in the US as well, because gasoline prices in the US surged 12.5% over the past month. So that was due to the winter storms and a rise in global demand, partly thanks to the ban that we have now on Russian oil and, well, the Chinese reopening story. And also, food price inflation remains high. It actually remains very, very high. So the Fed will certainly hike by 25 basis points this week, but there is little chance that it will announce the end of the monetary policy tightening, because Jerome Powell will certainly try to calm down the actual market joy, given that the actual market environment now suggests that the financial conditions in the US have actually become as loose as they were last February, before the Fed even started tightening its purse strings. And the more the market fights the Fed, the more aggressive the Fed should become to achieve what they need to achieve, meaning that 2% inflation target. So in summary, I think that we will have at least one or probably two more rate hikes to go in the US. So everybody will be all ears to hear whether the Federal Reserve says there will be further rate hike or further rate hikes on the pipeline. So that simple S could make all the difference this week. So this is all for today. I'm İpek Özkardeşkaya, and thank you for joining me, and thank you for all your beautiful messages. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below as usual. And follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow. And until then, good day trading.